Transfigured Night. I have lost the first story I have ever written. It was stored in Russian on a black floppy disk like in a coffin. It got damaged. Only hieroglyphs come up on the screen, unreadable. That is, when you find a computer that takes floppy disks, a technician said, beyond repair. A hard copy, if I ever had it, got stolen along with all my correspondence in a mustard colored suitcase when I moved continents. But I remember the story. It started with three 16-year-old girls, Lenka, Anka, and Svetka, arriving to Moscow on a midnight train from Russian province during winter vacation. They never traveled before. So they step outside the train station into the bright, cold light on a wide street, into the snow colored by the high full moon, and argue about what they do first. Go see Kremlin, go shopping, or go to a real bar. They have little money, almost none, but they are staying for free at Lenka's aunt's cousin, where they are headed as they talk. They don't have a real bar in their town. Only one restaurant that serves with stroganoff and sour cream and pasta, and it smells like a school canteen. They saw bars in movies, and they want to go to a real chic bar in Moscow, like this. They all just turned 16, and they have passports to prove it, so they'd buy cocktails in tall glasses with long stems, with cherries. As they talk about all this, they come to Lengazan's cousin's address, and a sleepy, angry old man tells them that she had died and slams the door in front of them. So the girls are outside, sit on a snow-covered bench, share a cigarette, and decide to go find a bar. And the bars are open all night long. The metro is still working. It's Moscow. And so they go to the station called Nikitsky Gates. Anka's neighbor's fiancé once went to Moscow and said, there is a bar there by Nikitsky Gates. So they take the last train to Nikitsky Gates and go outside to look for the gates. It is now starting to snow heavily and it is dark. No one is around. Gates are not there. There are wide window shops with beautiful white mannequins lounging and leaning on the walls, long arms and fingers and extended. Elegance.
Can you tell me if he's
better? One wears a gigantic white hat, but otherwise they're naked and glossy white, like the streets clad in ice and snow. The girls wear short skirts and high-heeled shoes and nylons, their best clothes. None of them owns a good pair of boots, and they wanted to look good in Moscow. It's Moscow. It's cold. They dance on the sidewalk to get warm. Smoke. A big black car stops. The only one in this dark street. A young woman, Asian, comes out of the car and looks around the street. They have never seen an Asian before. What are you doing here, girls, she says. She's wearing a white fur coat and lovely red shoes like a movie star. She sounds drunk. We are looking for Nikitsky Gates, says Svetka. It's here? But where are they? What? Gates? What gates? There are no gates, silly. It's just the name, a metro stop. If there were any gates, they exploded them a long time ago. Who did? Oh, God. She looks at them strange. But there is a bar in front of the gates. What bar? Did you fall off the moon? No, woman starts to laugh. Girls, she says, you freeze or cops will get you. Get into the car, come. But, whispers Svetka, get into the car, says the woman. They sit in the back, trembling first but warm after a while. The silent Asian driver blasts the heat and drives around and around all white streets, empty. A soft music plays and the woman smokes and talks. She tells the girl that she is Japanese, that her father is a diplomat, that her mother, though, is Russian, and that's how she learned to speak Russian so flawlessly in Tokyo, and how she is going to study the history of art, and she keeps talking and drinking. The car has a bar built in with real crystal and fancy glasses, and she keeps drinking amber dense liquid that smells so strong and good of fur coats and expensive cigarettes. The car stops by a palace. Thousands of lights, like bright stars, and coral, and sparkles, and glitters. Hotel Metropole shines the neon sign. Come, says the woman. She slides past the security guard, dropping, there with me. He looks like a frog in his green uniform. The woman gives him 100 rubles. Svetka sees it. 100 rubles, that's her mother's 2 months' salary. They follow the woman up the marble stairs and into a hall. Or actually, it is a dining room, or a sitting room, or a living room, or whatever they call these rooms in the movies. The girls all live with their moms and grandparents. All they have are sleeping rooms, two, one, with three or four people sleeping in the same room. But anyway, the girls have never been in a room big like this. It is like a theater. It has many couches, armchairs, pillows, and one wall is a bar. There are beautiful multicolored bottles sparkling. The Asian woman heads right there and pours herself a drink. A toilet, says Lenka. There. The woman waves her hand like a queen. Go. The girls run through the hall and run and run and run. And then they get into another hall. But that's a bathroom. It is as big as my whole entire flat, says Anka. Bigger, says Svetka. Everything is made of marble and crystal and so clean, it is glowing. They're afraid to sit on the toilet. It's so white. Like Anka's mother's holiday porcelain. There are little soaps and jars, and the towels are so soft, like kittens, says Lenka. They don't use the towel, just in case. They just touch it. They wipe their wet hands on their hair, put on some lipstick. They all have just one lipstick to share, and go back to the other hall. Now, there's a new man there, a short, stout Asian man in a black suit, and he's beating up the woman across her face. She's holding her arms in front of her, still in her fur coat. He's screaming something in broken Russian, and the girls hear, you Kazakh bitch, I told you to be good, to stay put. Didn't I tell you to bring little bitches here? Did I? The woman is weeping. But I was bored, Kiva-san. I was alone, and I was bored here all by myself. Her red shoe slips off her foot onto the carpet. She stumbles. Ga-ga-ga, shouts the man to the driver standing by the doorway. The driver steps out to the girls and there is something black in his hand. Run, run, shouts the woman. And the girls run out of the door and down the palace hallway and to the doors. And at the door, Anka looks back at the woman and sees that she falls on the white carpet, and there is blood gurgling and bubbling from her mouth, mixing with lipstick. They keep running down the marble stairs, hearing steps and shouts. Downstairs, two frogmen search their bags to see if little bitches stole anything, and then throw them out. They step outside in a full snow blizzard. Lenka searches through her purse. Her canvas bag with 30 rubles is gone. So with Svetka's envelope with 25 rubles, Anka still has her 17 rubles tackled into the bar, into the bra, just as her grandma taught her. I don't how the story ended. I think they took a cab for 3 rubles, went to some bar, and bought one drink to share. After all, they might have been picked up by some man who then bought them tickets back to Zanzibar. They could have gone straight to the railway station and struck a deal with train attendants to sleep in their bunks to get back home. Or they could have stayed in Moscow. They could have struck a deal with them. And he flew them across the vast cold ocean to New York, Manhattan, to a real bar, martini glasses, olives and all. They could have married millionaires for all I know, or overdosed in cheap Brooklyn brothels that smelled like feet and kefir. I don't know. It was all possible. It was 1990, and anything was possible in Moscow at the time. The air traveled with change, crime, and life. Too much life, too much crime. I don't remember. All I remember is a moving picture. Silent movie. Three scene, naked girls with arms snow white, waltzing and tumbling in the snow. In a blizzard, on a high, bright night, and what is incomprehensible but true, in the back, I see Nikitsky gates. The ones that never existed. In imperial marble grandeur. Ripple legs of an extinct mammal. A triumphal arch to nothing. Wild horses flying off the plank. Front legs scraping the sky. Nostrils chiseled. Harnesses cutting into their bronze lips. And behind, pulling the string. High on the chariot, so the winged evil and terribly beautiful angel, a pale rider, eyes blind.
Thank you.